Okay, good morning everyone. Good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Whilst we've got no apologies this morning, the convener is unable to attend in person, is hoping to follow the meeting online, which asked me to step in and chair it in those circumstances, which I'm happy to assist in doing. We move to agenda item 1, which is decision on taking business in private. Our first item of business today is a decision to take agenda items 3, 4, and 5 in private. We also need to decide whether the committee's consideration of evidence heard on the Social Security Amendment Scotland Bill should be taken in private at future meetings. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Agreed.
Okay, thank you for your assistance on that. And we move to agenda item 2. Our next agenda item is our second evidence session on the Social Security Amendment Scotland Bill, which is currently at stage 1. The bill amends the Social Security Scotland Act 2018 to make changes to the Scottish Social Security system. Last week, our evidence session provided a general overview of the bill. Today, we will focus on the concerns of specific groups of potentially vulnerable clients who would need support to navigate the system. And can I welcome in the room this morning Craig Smith, Senior Policy and Research Officer, the Scottish Association for Mental Health, SAMH, and Kirsty Henderson, Policy Officer, the Royal National Institute of Blind People, RNIB. Welcome to both of you this morning. Thank you for coming along. And can I also welcome online Claire Andrews, Legal Rights Officer, Legal Rights Services, also RNIB, and Alan Foulkes, Policy and Information Officer, the Health and Social Care Alliance Scotland, known as the Alliance. So thank you to both of our witnesses online for joining us as well. Okay, so a few housekeeping matters, as we always do at this point in the meeting. Could witnesses wait until myself or a member of the committee asks a question before coming in? That would be helpful. Do feel free to obviously draw to the clerk's attention online that you do wish to come in, or catch my eye if you're here in the room. We're not trying to dissuade anyone from speaking at all, but if you want to make the exact same point that we've just heard from someone else, don't feel the need to do that, because there's time constraints, so there's no need for every witness to answer every question. And something I'm particularly bad at, can those asking questions and those answering it please try to do so as concise as possible. So we'll now move straight to questions, and I'll open up if that's okay with witnesses. So the first theme we want to look at is part 3 of the bill on the ability to challenge decisions. What sorts of things should be considered exceptional circumstances that would justify a request for a redetermination or appeal being more than a year late? So that's that time bar of 1 year, unless there are exceptional circumstances. So what should the bar be for that? What kind of examples would witnesses like to give? What would they like to see be deemed to be exceptional circumstances? So who would like to go first in relation to that? Kirsty Henderson?
I don't mind going. Yeah. So we represent blind and partially sighted people, support them. So there has been research conducted by Loughborough University which looked at the barriers that blind and partially sighted people face when it comes to claiming uptake of benefits. Obviously, a key one is lack of accessible information. So if information, letters, correspondence isn't in a suitable format for the claimant, then they may not know what kind of information is being requested. Another key factor is the availability of support services as well to enable the person to navigate the welfare system. Another thing that was noted is the stigma of claiming welfare. So I suppose for some of our customers, the kind of, if they've recently been diagnosed with a sight loss condition, then there may be a lot of emotional factors involved. They might need time to deal with that, come to terms with it, and get support in place. So that again may delay the process of claiming benefits also, and could be a reason. There may be other factors as well, but they're some of the key ones for our clients.
Okay, that's very helpful. Kirsty, Alan Foulkes would like to come in at this point.
Good morning. Can I just, as a small correction, my job title now is Senior Policy Officer. So I think since the last time I came to the committee, it's changed. Also, just a small apology. I've got a lingering cough at the moment. So if that interrupts my evidence, I hope you'll bear with me. So in terms of some possible exceptional circumstances, I think it's impossible to be exhaustive. Obviously, it needs to be flexible to allow for sort of individual circumstances that can be very different for others. But we would generally suggest that might be things that would be disruptive to someone's life. So, for example, a health emergency that needs a significant hospital stay, whether someone has moved at short notice from home to residential care, they've perhaps experienced a bereavement or a change in provision of unpaid care either by or for themselves. Those are the kind of things that might create sort of a significant disruption in someone's life that unexpectedly prevents them from making a sort of an appeal within that sort of period.
Okay, thank you. Craig Smith.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with everything that's been said so far. One small correction too, we are now the Scottish Action for Mental Health, not Scottish Association for Mental Health. I will be told off if I don't correct that. So yeah, for us, we support people with mental health problems across Scotland. For one, we welcome the exceptional circumstances clauses being introduced and that people will be able to ask for a redetermination or appeal after a year. I mean, as a principle, we'd like that to be seen, while exceptional, as generously as possible, recognising the wide array of reasons why someone may not feel able, due to psychological and mental health reasons, for asking for redetermination within a year. Some particular examples would be, as Alan has said, periods of long stays in hospital, but also in terms of mental health context, people who are subject to compulsory treatment, be that in hospital or particularly in the community, may be a big barrier for asking for a redetermination within a year. So as generous as possible is what we'd like to see, which obviously might not jive very well with exceptional, but just having that kind of empathetic, compassionate approach to understanding the wide variety of kind of social or health considerations which may be a barrier for people engaging with the system. And I suppose one quick additional point to that would just be the general challenge of engaging with the system and accessing support, which has been mentioned, so accessing independent advice and advocacy. And people find it, particularly we've been told people with mental health problems can find it just really stressful to engage with the social security system, even with safeguards in place. So actually taking that decision to challenge a decision which you feel may not be right, so you'd like a redetermination, can take a long time to actually just build up that confidence and emotional kind of strength to engage with the system.
Okay, thank you. That's all very clear. And apologies for demoting one of our witnesses and misnaming the organisation of another. We're off to a champion start there, but the answers were far superior to the introductions. I'll move on with my questioning. We've heard some concerns about clients perhaps feeling a bit pressurised into withdrawing a redetermination or an appeal. Does the policy memorandum offer sufficient reassurance on that particular point? Again, I know the default is you look to people in the room, but Kirsty Henderson?
We did say in our response to the call for views, having a cooling off period, possibly 14 days, it may even be acceptable to extend that to 30 days. The reason being is that for a variety of reasons, a claimant may be persuaded to withdraw or may find the process itself too stressful and becomes overwhelmed, so may withdraw even if they've got a good chance of success. So the person may have not received independent advice or support. Again, we always try and encourage our clients to speak to an advisor to get information about their entitlement. We've seen, unfortunately, cases with DWP whereby they've made phone calls to claimants to try and persuade them to withdraw a redetermination or a mandatory reconsideration under DWP because they, you know, with the erroneous belief that they don't have a chance of success, whereas that's not often found to be true. We do have a number of case studies which we can send in as a supplementary paper to that practice where it has occurred in the DWP system.
Okay, Kirsty Henderson, your ask is very clear about the cooling off period, but that behaviour, irrespective of the DWP or any other, organisation. That would seem highly inappropriate or unprofessional. Is that anecdotal or is that considered to be wrong either way, anecdotal or widespread practices?
I would suggest anecdotal. I don't know if I'd defer to my colleague Claire if she would want to expand on that at all or not.
If Claire wanted to come in and just reflect on that, that would be very welcome also.
Yes, thank you. Appreciate that. I mean, I think in theory, this sounds like a positive move in terms of allowing people to withdraw redetermination that request if they choose to do so. I would be interested to know whether any sort of stats have been collated as to why they want to withdraw it. I would just say that in general terms, I'm not sure the policy intent would necessarily be correctly implemented. But in terms of the specific concern that Kirsty is raising, there is a practice within some aspects of the DDP system where after somebody has requested a mandatory reconsideration, that prompts a call, a telephone call from the original decision maker to provide an explanation of that original decision, which is not the same as carrying out a mandatory reconsideration, which best practice guidance would suggest needs to be done by somebody else. And that explanation call can be extremely confusing for our customers, often ending up with that request for a mandatory reconsideration not being acted upon, it being withdrawn, and the customer not actually being aware that that is what's taken place. And I think that's the concern that Kirsty is alluding to. But I'm fairly reassured that Social Security Scotland wouldn't be putting in place such a practice. Is that helpful?
That's very, very helpful. Still concerned that that practice may be ongoing with DWP. Does any other witnesses want to come in before we move on? Craig Smith, yeah.
Yeah, just really quickly. So, I mean, I agree, and I think we've heard anecdotal accounts of similar practices, but I don't have any particular evidence to kind of share on that at the moment. And I suppose for us, in terms of we welcome the right for someone to withdraw a redetermination, we think in a rights-based system, that is correct, that power is with the individual to choose that. But there does need to be no undue pressure put on the individual to withdraw. So I think we'd like to see a real clear framework of contact between the agency and the individual. We definitely have sympathy with a cooling-off period. And where someone is withdrawing a request for redetermination or appeal, that they're clearly signposted to independent advice and advocacy and given that opportunity to access those independent advice services before making a final decision.
That's all very helpful. Thank you. Can we move on now to our next line of questioning? Can I bring in Katie Clark, MSP?
Yes, and I was wanting to ask whether you think lapsed appeals should be allowed, even if what is offered isn't the best possible award that could be achieved at tribunal. And if I maybe ask Sam H maybe to come in first.
So on lapsed appeals, so this is where the agency determines that there's been an error and makes a new determination mm-hmm. while an appeal is ongoing. I mean, I think broadly in principle, we agree that that is a good thing, that a new determination can happen. We welcome in the bill that there is some safeguard. So at the consultation prior to the bill, we had some concerns around this, particularly where someone may not get the full amount that they could get at a tribunal. So while that is still a concern for us, we do welcome in the bill that the individual now needs to give kind of explicit consent that they're accepting the new determination and that the new determination has to be more advantageous kind of financially than the initial determination. So that is welcome. I think in kind of principle, we would still like someone to be able to continue with the original appeal if they want to, so it's good that they need to provide consent. And we do welcome that there's full challenge rights to the new determination. So where the agency makes a determination and the appeal is lapsed, that individual still can ask for redetermination on the new determination and on subsequent appeal, which does add quite a few steps into an already stressful process. But I think those safeguards do give us some reassurance over it. But I mean, ultimately, if someone wishes to go to tribunal to achieve or they believe they will be entitled to the full benefit amount, they should be able to do that.
Yeah. Okay. Anyone else want to go in relation to that question?
I think really just to echo what's been said already, I think Yeah, we would obviously argue that the person accepts what their full statutory entitlement is, even if the redetermination is a better offer than what they've had subsequently. As Craig said, I think given the person the opportunity to seek independent advice as to whether that is a good offer, and again, consent and the individual agreeing to it. So, yeah.
Okay, thank you. I think Claire wanted to come in also. Just, do you want to add to some of that?
Yeah, I just wanted to say that I think in principle we agree with this, because we do know that our customers can find the thought of going forward to an appeal quite stressful, and obviously there are, you know, protections to the public purse, etc. But really the mention of robust guidance is going to be really crucial in this space, because again, there's been a lot of confusion within the DWP system as to how this is carried out. And so I just wanted to sort of flag that robust guidance is going to be absolutely fundamental. You may come onto this in a minute, so stop me, but we do have an issue with the requirement to have a redetermination on a new determination before going forward to an appeal, because that could create a kind of redetermination loop for a customer. So just to put that out there at this point.
Alan Falls wants to go in as well.
Yeah, excuse me. Just very briefly, because a lot of what I was going to say has already been covered, but just that it might seem a bit counterintuitive to some people that someone might not want to go through a process to push for the maximum possible. But in a rights-based system, they might be happy with what they get offered in the redetermination. And if they are happy with that, and they can make sort of informed consent on that, that, you know, they're able to access independent advice and advocacy, if they are happy to take that, then that should be respected. And that's an important part of respecting individual choice and decision-making within the system.
Okay. Katie, just before I bring you back in, Jeremy, mm-hmm. Just hold on to your supplementary for a moment. I'll let Katie finish her line of questioning, and then if you come with your supplementary, and then you've got the next team anyway, that would be helpful.
Thank you. Last week, Erica Young from Citizens Advice argued that clients ought to be able to go straight to appeal without having to go to a redetermination first. On the other hand, however, another witness, Dan Connick from Stirling Council, thought that might be too daunting for people. So I was wanting to ask witnesses their views, and maybe have asked Claire first.
Thank you. I wasn't sure from this question whether you meant specifically in terms of what we've been talking about, which is the sort of lapsed appeal, or whether the question was in general terms, should the redetermination route be removed from the system in its entirety?
I think probably in more general terms, but obviously you could focus on the specific if that is something that you've got a view on.
Well, specifically, I think the requirement for redetermination on a new determination that would lapse an appeal should be removed, and they should go straight to the right to an appeal. But in terms of the actual redetermination process itself, we have mixed views on this, and I think it's fair to say that one particular system isn't always going to be the best system for everybody. We acknowledge an appeal could be off-putting, and the redetermination might feel more approachable. And to be in terms of how Social Security Scotland work, you know, provided that the system of redetermination is a robust system, and it seems that it is, looking at the percentages of cases that are, that awards that are changed at the redetermination process, and because of the time constraint on carrying out a redetermination, our overarching view is that the redetermination process is working and should remain.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if any other witnesses have indicated.
I think Kirsty Henderson indicated, yes.
I mean, to echo what's said, I think obviously the mandatory reconsideration process as introduced by DWP in around 2013 only served to delay decisions for a number of claimants. The good thing with what Social Security Scotland have in place is the fact that there is a time limit in which the agency can make a decision. That gives the claimants some protection, and it also, you know, if they choose, they can, if they've not done it within the particular time limit, they can take it to an independent tribunal if they wish. So I think that's a good protective factor.
Okay, thank you. Craig Smith?
Just kind of very briefly, I suppose for us, I mean, the overarching principle being decisions should be correctly made as early as possible. So I think looking forward to how particular adult disability payment is operating in Scotland going forward, I mean, the principle needs to be there. Obviously, we want to minimise mandatory reconsiderations and appeals. Ultimately, in a system that's operating properly, decisions should be correctly made on application, an initial assessment. But in saying that, there's always going to be people, there's always going to be mistakes, and also the system itself is subjective in terms of assessors do need to come to a decision on fairly complex criteria and evidence. So for us, I think it's a bit of a waiting game. We do have some sympathy with that kind of line of thinking that actually people should have the right to go directly to appeal, because inherently challenging decisions is stressful, particularly stressful, well, for everyone, but particularly if there's a pre-existing or ongoing mental health concern. But I think for us it's a bit of a waiting game to see how the Scottish system is operating. If we were in a position where the vast majority of mandatory reconsiderations are being overturned at appeal, then I think there's a strong argument for mandatory reconsideration isn't working because it's not making the correct decision. Go straight to appeal, there would be more evidence. But I don't think we're quite there in terms of evidence. I was having a quick look at the stats yesterday, and I think it's about 54% of ADP appeals are successful. So about half of appeals are successful, but numbers are fairly low because ADP is new, so there's not that many appeals yet. So I think it's something to kind of look to the future. But in a functioning system, I think our preference would be retaining mandatory reconsideration and appeal. But if we get to a position, I think, if we look at the DWP system a few years ago, where so many reconsiderations, get my terminology right, were being overturned, then there is a kind of strong argument for why you're making people going through this additional stage, which isn't actually working very well in practice.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thanks, Katie. Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Mayor. Just in regard to representation, my understanding is that if the client or your client ticks the box to have representation, that only lasts for 3 months, and then you have to go for consent again. Is that right? And does that mean that you can't represent your clients fully? Should it be representation all the way through to whenever the first tier tribunal makes a decision? Would that be easier for you as agencies working, or am I misunderstanding that?
Is that the
Kirsty? I don't know. Oh, anyone really?
I'm happy to come in there. I'm not particularly involved as a welfare rights advisor now. I think it would obviously make sense that if a claimant has named an advice agency or any other person on their form, that person should, you know, and gave consent, that should last for the duration of the claim, including when the decision is made as well. I think 3 months, it's a bit of an arbitrary kind of time frame to have. It has been noted, and I think welfare rights agencies in general would appreciate kind of escalation routes as well, just to add in that escalation routes and getting through to speak to advisers within Social Security Scotland would be a big advantage. I know that's not directly related to this, but I think would ease the communication between advice agencies, welfare rights officers and the agency and the claimant, where that support's in place too. Thank you.
If I can move us on. One of the principles in the policy memorandum is that persons who benefited from the overpaid sums will ultimately be liable to pay them. Does this justify making individuals liable for overpayments called by the representatives? And I'm happy for anyone to jump in on this one.
I can go first. So this was something that was one of the areas of the bill that was most contentious for us when we were coming to our view on it. I think ultimately we agree with the proposals. Kind of in principle, the person who benefits should be liable, and that will be maybe the individual, even though it might be an appointee or representative who is the one who's actually handled that claim. I think there's a real danger of disincentivising people to take up appointeeships, and that would be. And they play such a vital and crucial safeguard for people, including people without capacity or people in the Scottish system with capacity who decide they would like an appointee because they find engaging with the social security system challenging. So I think ultimately we do agree with where the bill has landed, but with some kind of caution, because ultimately you're holding an individual responsible for something that they haven't necessarily done, but they have benefited from it. So it is a challenging one, but we think the balance is kind of just about kind of right there, particularly because, I mean, this doesn't include where, for example, an appointee has financially exploited an individual or something. This is in terms of where there's kind of good faith errors in the system that someone has made. We do welcome that where the agency has made the error in terms of overpayments, that there will be no liability kind of on anyone. But where there is a good faith error, ultimately, it should be who has benefited. But we do recognise that can be really difficult to determine, particularly where you may have a family member who's appointee and some of this money may be going to shared budgeting. So I think there needs to be really kind of clear guidance and a framework about how liability in these cases is determined. And kind of as principle throughout, we believe people with lived experience of disability need to be kind of involved in developing any kind of guidance and framework around these kind of questions.
Would you like to come in?
Yeah, similarly, we do recognise there's quite a difficult balance to strike here, and we do agree with the rationale of you don't want to penalise people who've made errors in good faith, as that may discourage people from providing this supportive role. And we do need to recognise throughout this process that, you know, everyone is only human, we do make mistakes, and as a bit of a tangent, that also applies to those administering the system, which is why we have redeterminations and appeals. So addressing those mistakes in a fair and dignified manner is important. I do think it makes sense in this context that the overpaid sum is recovered from the person who received the payment, as it was an overpayment for them, rather than recovering it from the person responsible for the error. If it's a good faith error, they won't have had any benefit from the payment. We do think caution needs to be taken that this doesn't cause any financial hardship for people, so it needs to be reclaimed appropriately, perhaps in small sums over a period of many months. And obviously, where there has been actual fraud or abuse on the part of the third party, that's a different matter, and they should be liable. And I would agree with Craig that I think the bill does strike sort of the right balance in that area, though it is a difficult balance to strike.
Thank you. I mean, I think just going back to you briefly, Craig, and maybe you've answered this already, is how do you think this would actually work in practice? So, you know, obviously, and what are your views? Can it work in practice? And how do you think, do we need more guidance around it, how it would actually work in practice?
I probably don't have a very straightforward answer to that, because I think it is very difficult for it to work out in practice. So the guidance will be really key, and taking time to get that right, and having how these things are investigated and determined in terms of liability will be really key. But I mean, it isn't straightforward, particularly, as I say, in considerations where there may be appointee who's a family member or a close friend, where there may be joint budgeting in terms of joint travel, joint food bills and things that the benefit may have gone towards contributing. So while we agree with the principle, I think there does need to be a lot of time taken to think about how it will work in practice and how these things are decided on a case-by-case basis. And I absolutely agree with Alan's point about, in terms of repayment of overpayments, that needs to be done very much on an individual basis, ensuring that no one is forced into financial destitution, or indeed that their health is negatively impacted by repaying.
I think you've drawn a distinction between something done innocently and then financial abuse. And do you think these provisions will tackle instances of financial abuse?
I think the bill gets it right in terms of liability around financial abuse, in terms of where an appointee has financially abused the individual who's claiming benefit, that they will be held liable. And I think that is an entirely kind of separate situation. So yes, we absolutely agree they need to be held liable in those cases, and determining that, and determining if financial abuse or it's been an honest mistake, can be quite challenging as well. So there needs to be a real clear framework for gathering evidence around that in a sensitive way, and for all parties involved. But absolutely, we agree that there needs to be liability on an individual who has financially abused someone, and they need to be removed as an appointeeship, and there's provisions in the bill, not in the bill, but in the system to allow that to happen.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay. Liz McCall.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you. And this has already been alluded to by yourself, Craig, so I'm going to ask this question of others, if that's okay. Do you think that making representatives liable in this way for overpayments and the misuse of money will actually affect people's willingness to become a representative? And I would say Craig's already highlighted that concern, but if I could go to Claire first, maybe, get the women to come in and see if we can get a different view, because it's already been highlighted. So Claire, can you give me what you think on that? And do you think it's actually going to sort of stop people putting themselves forward to represent?
Firstly, I'd just like to say that I appreciate the clarification as to what we mean by representative in this situation, that we're not looking at advice agencies. And I agree with pretty much what everybody else has been said here in terms of that this is a really hard balance act to juggle. And I think you have tried to kind of accommodate a variety of circumstances and situations. I do think it will be hard to implement in practice. I think potentially it could be off-putting to a small number of people, but I think that's probably a risk worth taking in the round.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I think a lot of people, for example, will take a position of authority in a legal sense over a loved one, not really understanding the full ramifications of what that actually means. Power of attorney, for example, can very easily be taken because you're helping somebody and wanting to care for somebody, but actually not knowing what the ramifications of that power of attorney actually means. So I think there is a very important point on this. Kirsty, could you give me your opinion on whether you think this will stop people from actually putting themselves forward in that position, or even that understanding that they might not actually know what it is they're putting themselves forward for?
Yeah, they may not know. A blind, partially sighted person might have a family member who's helping them with banking and whatnot and money matters. I think when it comes to sort of representative roles and responsibilities, it may be helpful to have that information clearly set out and made available in accessible formats for the representative as well as for the claimant as well, just so they understand the nature of what could, you know, what the responsibility and role entails. I appreciate it could be slightly different, but just, I suppose, an overview may be helpful.
That's helpful. Thank you. Can move on to the next question. Will these provisions help tackle instances of financial abuse? Again, this has been touched upon, but I'd like a little bit more information if that's possible. So in your opinion, and again, I'm going to go back to Claire again first, will these provisions help tackle instances of financial abuse in your opinion?
I'm going to be very honest and say we don't have a huge amount of experience of this area. Blind and partially sighted people typically don't need appointees, as long as, you know, documents are provided in accessible formats. That's not necessarily a requirement. So I don't give this response from any kind of, you know, professional experience of it. But I think potentially, but it all comes back to what you've just said in terms of people really understanding what their role as an appointee is and what that entails and how liable they could be in certain circumstances, and then how that is followed up, policed, monitored and implemented. So the answer is potentially, but I really don't know. We'll have to see how it would play out. Sorry.
No, Claire, thank you very much indeed for a very open and honest answer. I appreciate it. Maybe Alan could come in then.
Yes. Just specifically on financial abuse, I would say I don't think it's really possible for social security legislation by itself to sort of disincentivise financial abuse. It's hopefully very, very rare, but it strikes me as such extreme behaviour that if someone is going to do it, they're probably going to do it regardless. And it's instead of it making sure that the consequences for that abuse sort of fall on the person who's responsible for it in the first place. And just a very brief point about the sort of putting people off, just the previous point, because I put an R in that, just to say that I think that so few people would misuse the money or act in a bad way. I think that I don't think people are going to be put off by the sense that if they commit wrongdoing, they'll be held liable. I think most people would expect that if they do wrong, they get held liable. So I wouldn't see it as sort of being too discouraging in this scenario.
That's very, very helpful. Thank you. I'm moving on to appointees now, so slightly different shift. And Craig, this is very much for you. SAMH were instrumental in shaping the Social Security Scotland provisions for authorising appointees. Can the explain the problems, excuse me, can explain the problems with the DWP process and how the Scottish process differs in that?
So, yes, we were quite instrumental in terms of the Social Security Administration and Tribunals Bill. I always get the name wrong, in terms of changes to the appointees in Scotland. And kind of in a couple of areas. So it's not so much necessarily that the problems with the DWP system, but there are some problems in terms of particularly challenging appointees, having appointees changed. But I suppose the additional safeguards in Scotland, which we feel are kind of key, particularly in regards to people who have capacity but who would like an appointee. So in Scotland, there's now third-party certification in that circumstances. So where someone would like an appointee but they do have capacity, so they're not getting an appointeeship because they fall under adults with incapacity. You have that right in Scotland now to have an appointee, and that appointee goes through a process where there's third-party certification, which involves ensuring they understand the role of being an appointee, the individual themselves understand the role of having an appointee, and they can withdraw their consent for having an appointee at any time, and ensuring that the individual hasn't been placed under undue influence in agreeing to an appointeeship, and that the person is designated kind of suitable. So there's that additional safeguard. The Scottish system, I believe, is also a bit more rigorous in terms of challenging appointeeships. So it's written into legislation that Scottish ministers and the agency basically need to take the views of people who have the individual themselves, where that's appropriate and proportionate, but also any other individuals that have a financial or welfare concern about that individual. So if someone, another family member, someone who knows the individual is concerned that an appointee is maybe not acting in the interests of the individual, they can raise that and they can trigger a review of the appointeeship. So there's some additional safeguards built into the Scottish system that we really welcome.
Okay, thank you. Does anybody else want to come in on that question? I didn't think so. We're shaking heads. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you, Ros. Paul O'Kane.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I suppose following on from that point, I'm interested in how the current process is working, particularly in terms of transferring the people from PIP into either adult disability payment or child disability payment, and really how quickly, I suppose, the authorisation process is actually working for those people who are being transferred. So I don't know if anyone has any views or insight into that current process. Kirsty.
I'm going to say at the end, we've actually had contact and we will be hosting a number of focus groups with blind and partially sighted people at the end of the month. It's just a shame that they haven't taken place beforehand. So we will have, I hope, some really good evidence. I think just the kind of original principles with the whole idea of transferring from ADP DLA to ADP and PIP to ADP was that the process would be as light touch as possible, particularly where a person may have been registered as sight impaired or severely sight impaired for some time. We wouldn't expect them to have to go through too arduous a process. I appreciate that in some instances the agency might ask for supporting information. We were kind of informed that the responsibility should lie with the agency for collecting that. And obviously for blind and partially sighted people, there could be additional barriers to sending in supporting information should it not be in an accessible format. More than happy to send in kind of feedback once we have more feedback from people who've gone through that process.
Thank you. Yeah, Convener, I think that would be helpful to committee if there is further information. I'm not sure if anyone else has a view in terms of the work that they're doing with other groups, if you like.
I mean, just very similar to Kirsty, we're happy to send in any additional information we have. We are trying to do some work, obviously, ahead of the independent review of ADP, which will be coming up. But we recognise that many of the people that we support through services at SAMH are still in receipt of PIP and haven't transferred yet or in the process of transferring. So actually, we're still in the stage of trying to really kind of gathering information on people's experience of transfer or making a new claim to ADP, but we're happy to share any additional information when we have it.
It's maybe an appropriate point. I would normally say at the end of the meeting, but you know, if there is other evidence you want to draw to our attention, where this is ongoing, this is not your one opportunity to put on the record what you believe is important. So, Kirsty Henderson, thank you for that offer, and likewise Craig Smith. But to all witnesses, just it's an iterative process. Any other information you want to draw to our attention, please do that on an ongoing basis. I'll bring in John Mason now.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, the area I want to ask about is audit and the idea that information can be required and there could be penalties if people do not provide the right information. The government talks about they have to get information so that they can establish estimates of error and fraud. So my first question is, do witnesses agree with suspending a person's benefit payments if they repeatedly fail to provide information to Social Security Scotland? And maybe I think RNIB have views on this. Kirsty is Henderson, yes.
Thank you. Yeah, we do have major concerns about suspension of a person's benefit. The consequences of any suspension of a benefit could be very harmful to a claimant, particularly if they only become aware of it due to lack of funds available, for example, in a bank account. It could have other repercussions as well, some of which could be quite dire for claimants, as we've already seen with the kind of sanctions. I appreciate that was a different process, but it was effectively stopping payment because of lack of information from the claimant. So we also feel that it should be a last resort, and that the inherent vulnerability of a client should be considered beforehand, and that it may include the fact that they may have had a change in circumstances since the last time that the agency was in touch with them. For example, if they have had a deterioration in sight, they may not be able to read letters or correspondence which is sent to them. Sort of mental ill health, if people are experiencing a deterioration, that could be another factor where responding to correspondence would put them under additional stress or pressure. I think where possible, a range of communication methods should be used, so that, you know, it's not, and there's various ways of trying to establish contact with the claimant. So it's not just, you know, a letter or two, and then there's the suspension. So yeah, that's really all.
Do you think, I mean, on that kind of theme, that if perhaps somebody, say their eyesight has deteriorated, they might need more support than they've needed previously. I mean, do you think there's some way that support can be provided or should be provided in that kind of situation?
Yeah, I suppose it might be difficult to ascertain whether the person has support in place or not already. I think it should be kind of proactively offered to people if they don't have support in place. There is the independent advocacy service that's available through the agency, and there's a local delivery service as well, should a person, and that might be a suggestion even, that if a person doesn't respond or fails to provide information, that the local delivery service have a role in actually following up with that person locally.
Okay, that's helpful, thanks. Mr Smith, do you have a view on this?
I mean, on the principle kind of the original question, is a clear no. We don't think anyone's benefits should be ended or suspended because they don't provide information for audit. We absolutely recognise that the system needs to be audited and needs to be clear information through audits, and they play an important role. But we're talking about individuals who are not suspected of fraud, who are not suspected of making an error, who are at risk of having their claim entirely ended or suspended. If we're thinking about ADP, adult disability payment, we're considering people who may have a wide range of vulnerabilities, including mental health problems, including suicidal ideation, including real challenges in general engaging with the system. So to be asked to take part in an audit process is inherently, could just be inherently very challenging for them. So, I mean, we do welcome that there are some safeguards built into the bill around the right of of advocacy, independent advocacy being really key, the right to have a supporter with someone when they're involved in any kind of interviews around audit purposes and gathering of information for audit. So we do welcome those, but ultimately we don't feel that it's proportionate to have, even as a last resort, someone's benefit being ended because they don't want to take part or they're not compliant with audit requests. Mm. I think this really does conflate fraud and error and audit together, and the consequences just don't seem proportionate for us. And on the principle, there was no consultation on this aspect as well. In the consultation ahead of the bill, obviously it wasn't in the call for views, so we would like to see much more consultation. And if these have to go ahead, and if that is going to be ultimately ending someone's benefit, does remain, we need to have really clear co-produced guidance with people with mental health problems and other disabilities, mm-hmm. and a wide array of stakeholders involved in producing kind of the framework and guidance about how that would work in practice and what additional safeguards could be built into the system. But yeah, ultimately we don't think it's proportionate that anyone's benefit should be ended because they don't wish to or don't comply with requests for audit.
Yeah, witnesses we've had previously have made the same point as yourself about, you know, audit's one thing, but, you know, chasing up fraud and error is slightly different. Sorry.
Apologise to cut across you, but I think it's quite a significant question, and we're two witnesses online also want to go and put some thoughts on this as well, if that's OK.
I'll come to them, so I'll kind of follow up with Mr Smith first, and then I'll come back to the people who are online.
As long as you do, that's fine.
Is that OK?
Yes.
Yep. So I think, yes, yeah, so what we're going to ask you was... The way you've just described it, you know, some people will be fine providing the information and others won't. Do you think there should be certain people should just be totally exempt from this?
I think we need a really generous interpretation of kind of good reason for people being exempt. So for us, we would see particularly anyone who's subject to compulsory treatment, so mental health treatment, under a mental health order should be exempt. But more generally, where engaging in the process could be deemed as potentially harmful to someone's health, we think they should be exempt. So I think there needs to be kind of a co-produced kind of approach to sort of developing that guidance about which groups of people would be exempt and on what grounds. But generally, as a principle, where engaging with the process would have a detrimental impact to someone's health, we believe they should be excluded from it.
That's great. Thanks. Right, Mr. Falls, what have you got thoughts on this?
Yeah, and just to sort of add to one of Craig's points, this wasn't obviously consulted on in the original pre-legislative phase, and I think that's resulted in a little bit of confusion. I think we hadn't appreciated in our call for views response that the audit process would be at random, and we would therefore be very concerned about suspending payments for failure to comply with information requests. You know, it shouldn't be treated like fraud or actually identified fraud and error, and there is a significant risk to financial and mental health and well-being of individual in question, especially given, and we need to bear in mind with Social Security more generally, that a lot of people already have a lot of distrust and trauma because of what is often a very punitive system at UK level, and that for all Social Security Scotland's good intentions, that can carry over to the devolved benefits as well. We need to be very careful how we sort of communicate and approach people with these kinds of things. Also have a bit of a question on you, well, what further information is going to be necessary for audit purposes, separate from that which was already provided to, you know, demonstrate eligibility for the payment in the first place? If we're talking about a random sample, you know, a lot of people might just provide exactly the same information again. And again, it feels like a very harsh step to suspend someone's payment for not providing information that they may already have provided. So just a lot of concern about how this would work in practice. And yeah, just to echo that, we really don't think that people's payments should be suspended for failure simply to provide information once they've already established a valid claim.
Ms. Andrews, any further thoughts on that point?
It's largely been covered. I just very briefly would say that, you know, the barriers to blind and partially sighted people around a lack of clear information, accessing support to comply, the amount of input that's required of them, and welfare stigma, that's all part of the barriers. And I think this audit process will absolutely feed into that, particularly the sense of welfare stigma and a kind of constant feeling of having to demonstrate and prove entitlement. And so yeah, we absolutely would not support suspension of benefits in this scenario. And you have to remember that people may already be having deductions from other means-tested benefits as a part of a sort of debt recovery. It could leave people in great financial hardship. And I think a test and learn approach to this audit would be a much better system, where suspension is just not part of it initially, or ever, ideally, but certainly not initially.
didn't quite catch what you said just now. What would be better than doing it this way?
I honestly think the audit process needs to embark on a test and learn approach, and therefore that there is no suspension during that test and learn approach. And so we look at compliance within this space. We look at the problems that people have in terms of engaging and put measures in to support them, and that there is no suspension of benefits during that period. I mean, ideally not at all ever, but if it were to go ahead.
Yeah, I think you're starting on what I was going to ask next, because, I mean, the government's...
Apologies.
I'm delighted. The government's argument is if they just make it all voluntary and don't actually go back to the recipients of the payments, then it's all going to be too vague, and they wouldn't be able to find out if there had been error or whatever. I mean, is your feeling that it can be done another way? Do you think the test and learn system could do that?
Well, I think we're talking about potentially two different things, that the audit model itself should allow for the fact that some people aren't going to respond to it. And I think also we're not talking about an opt-out either necessarily. We're talking about a generous acceptance of good reason. And then the second part of that being, which I've just completely forgotten what I was going to say, so apologies, and we'll come back to it.
Come back to you if you want. Mr. Falls, did you want to come back in at this point as to what else we could... No, you're shaking your head, are you? That's OK. I don't know if either of the ones in the room want to see, you know, what else could the government do? I'll come back to you just in a minute.
This is John.
Sorry?
They're called witnesses.
Witnesses, what did I say?
People the ones.
The people in the room. Witnesses, right. Would either Mr. Smith or Ms. Henderson, have you any thoughts about what the government could do other than this? Or what Social Security Scotland could do other than this? Is there a better way of auditing?
I mean, I would just reiterate kind of what Alan had said about, I think we need to really think about what the purpose of, what additional information are we looking for? So I absolutely don't have a kind of model for auditing kind of in my head, but I'm thinking about from the claim data, from redetermination data and appeals data, can we not make some determinations on rates of error from that information, from those information sources? I'm certainly not an auditor, so I'm sure there's lots of very good reasons why you would want to do a kind of whole independent auditing process. But yes, I mean, we just reiterate what I said, that I don't think that it would be proportionate that people could risk their benefits for not taking part in that. So.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of agree with you. I mean, auditing, as I understand it, on the whole, we don't always have to go to the customers. We're auditing a shop. We don't go speak to all the customers. We audit what's in the shop. Did you have anything else, Ms. Henderson? No. I was going to come back to you, Ms. Andrews. You were at another point.
Sorry, it was just to kind of say that I was trying to make a second point, which is that they're two separate things, that the audit model itself, but specifically in terms of the test and learn, I think what I was referring to then is actually looking at how people do engage with this process and what's the best way of trying to engage people with this process and what support is needed to help people engage with this process. So they're two things, really, the audit model itself and then the test and learn in terms of engagement, and that there should be no suspension during that period. Thank you.
OK, I think that's me, convener. Thank you.
OK, that's very brief for you, Mr. Mason, in relation to audit purposes, but there we are. We'll move on to the next line of questioning. Marie McNair.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel, in the room and online. Much appreciated your time this morning. I wanted to ask, does anyone have any comments on specific measures in the bill not already discussed? And I'll just pop it out to those that are in the room first. Craig, would you mind coming in? Have you got anything?
Yeah, I mean, just briefly, I keep saying that and then not being very brief at all. I suppose in part one on the bill, we broadly welcome the opportunity to move the framework for child, additional child payment, not additional child payment. Pardon me while I get my actual place. For the Scottish child payment, moving that away from the use of top-up benefits. We do think that provides the opportunity to decouple from the reserve benefit system. So if there was any tightening or restrictions around universal credit or other qualifying benefits, that eligibility for the Scottish Child Payment could be protected. And it does provide the opportunity to look at how we may want to kind of redesign Scottish Child Benefit as well, to extend the eligibility, with the caveat that one of the one of the kind of key positives of the Scottish Child Benefit is the simplicity of the application and kind of assessment process. And if we entirely decouple and have to create a whole new process of assessing someone's eligibility, there would be some kind of concerns around that, and that would need a lot of thought. But kind of principally, we'd like to see that protected from any potential retrenchment of UK level wide benefits. So that's welcome. So that's kind of one additional area.
Thanks, Craig. Anyone else? Alan?
Yeah, certainly I was going to make the similar point about the putting the Scottish Child Payment on its own footing. That's very welcome, and it prevents anyone sort of being excluded from the payment that it's not the Scottish Government or the Scottish Parliament's policy intention to exclude. So that's good. The other thing I'd wanted to highlight on this specific front is the proposal for a care leaver payment. I think that's a very positive suggestion, and we certainly responded to the separate consultation on that very, very positively. I think it's a good opportunity to provide further support to a group of people who face quite unique challenges compared to others in society, and it does show the kind of positive change that's possible, you know, with the devolution of social security power. So we think that both of those things a very positive step.
Thank you, Alan. I move then on to my next question. To what extent does the bill as a whole align with the social security principles? And I'll stay with yourself, Alan, just if you want to come back in. If not, I'll move on.
So in general, we consider the bill to align quite well with those principles. So if we're talking about the improvements, particularly around choice and redetermination appeals processes, those align quite well with the principles around human rights and dignity. Processes that will allow, you know, for redeterminations of people to get higher payments align quite well with the principle of investment in the people of Scotland. But going back to the previous theme of discussion, you know, we would be concerned about some of the provisions around those randomly selected audits, which could result in individuals losing payments purely due to not submitting information when asked for it, rather than any actual wrongdoing. That perhaps seems a bit at odds with those principles of fairness and human rights and dignity and investment. And it appears to sort of elevate value for money through a random error sampling for statistical purposes. It sort of elevates that principle above the other principles, and we're a bit sort of concerned about that. But overall, we would say that, yes, the bill does align quite well with those social security principles.
Thanks for that, Alan. Anyone else want to come in?
Yeah, quickly come in. I think for blind and partially sighted people, obviously the key is accessible information and inclusive communication, which I appreciate is already in the primary legislation, which was is an amazing kind of thing for people with visual impairments and for the agency as a whole. I think it's just key to ensure that that is built in throughout any amendments also and works in practice. That was really all I wanted to add in.
Thanks, yeah. Kirsty.
Thank you.
No one else?
I mean, very briefly, basically just to agree with what Alan said. Overall, we believe the bill as a whole aligns very well, fairly well. I think we need to see how it works in practice in terms of the set of principles, particularly dignity and human rights and continuous improvement in terms of rights for late redeterminations being an example of that. But we have big concerns about the audit principles and think that's not in tune with the principles, particularly around human rights and being treated with dignity and respect. But overall, we generally believe it's fairly in line with the social security principles.
Thank you, Craig. Finally, in what way would the bill improve the client experience? Are there any provisions that would make client experience worse? And is there anything that you think is missing?
Might be gathering their thoughts just now, because being asked a question that includes what else would you have in the bill, I'm sure, as you absolutely should do, Mary, there was something to say, but who wishes to go? That wasn't the only part of the question, of course. Who wishes to go first? Go to Claire Andrews.
Thanks, Claire.
Thank you. I think, you know, in terms of the sort of flexibility and claimant choice being built into the sort of redeterminations and appeals process, that's going to improve the client experience as long as those robust guidelines are robust enough. And we're always keeping an eye on the fact that that is an informed decision and an informed choice. Provisions that would make the client experience worse, I think that comes as no surprise to anybody in the room, because we've all said it really, which is the proposed audit. I think that's going to be the difficult one for people to stomach. I just wanted to say very quickly that it hasn't come up in this session, but there is a section about process appeals, and there is something in that needs looking at in terms of a process appeal loop, where somebody can be sent back to Social Security Scotland after a process appeal because further information is required. And if that further information isn't provided, there is then a further possibility to go to a process appeal, and you end up in this system of never getting out of a process appeal. And I just think that that's something that, if that plays out how it's read, then that could be quite difficult from a client experience perspective, and it just probably needs a bit of scrutiny. But other than that, you know, I think the bill is fairly uncontentious, apart from in respect of the audit process.
So that clear. Anyone else want to come in before I hand back to the convener? No.
Back to yourself, I got convener. That all wrong, Marie McNair. Everyone didn't want to come in. My apologies. I know we've got some supplementaries Mr. Balfour, what's happening here? So we have no further questions, but I'll just give that appeal because we'll do a wee bit of time. If there's something that you kind of wanted to say, but our line of questioning has been down the kind of pathway to allow you to put on the record what you wish to put on the record, we've got a wee bit of time, or just a final comment, or maybe just get around our witnesses to provide that opportunity. We'll maybe start with the witnesses online first of all. Alan Fall, is there anything you want to add before we close this evidence session?
To be honest, perhaps I think I've covered all the points I would have wanted to make during the discussion anyway, so I'm quite happy to leave it there.
That may be a theme. Claire?
Just in terms of part two, the repeal of section 52B of the 2018 Act, I just think that there's an opportunity for Social Security Scotland to look at backdating rules, allowing for late applications of benefits beyond, obviously, we're getting rid of the COVID restriction, but it would seem that exceptional circumstances are being considered elsewhere, but they seem to be absent from that area. So that's something that might be, would take the opportunity to raise.
Thank you. Kirsty Henderson, anything you want to add before we close the evidence session?
No, as I said, I think the key point was that accessible communication, inclusive communication, accessible information is fundamental for our clients. The other point is just around the fact that Social Security Scotland have set up and delivered a very, you know, a system which is for people of Scotland. We're about to see that ramp up considerably this year with the introduction of pension age winter heating payment and eventual replacement of an attendance allowance of pension age disability payment. You know, it's going to increase the caseload hugely, so we'd hope that these principles are just embedded. It's just a general point on that, and that the focus on claimants isn't lost in that huge operation that needs to happen.
Okay, thank you for putting that on the record. Craig Smith?
I think I've said most that I would have liked to say, but I suppose just to kind of emphasise where the bill, and there's many places where and it's welcome that it does so, that there's good reason provisions or exceptional circumstance provisions, particularly around kind of late applications, late redetermination requests, or good reasons around lapse appeals. Just to kind of emphasise that the guidance built around that is going to be absolutely key, and we'd always be arguing for that guidance to be designed and preferably co-designed and co-produced with people with lived experience of mental health problems and disabilities more generally, and kind of a wide array of stakeholders, just to ensure that we get those provisions right. So it generally is good reasons, and we, as I think I've said a few times throughout the session, we'd always be arguing for those to be generously understood by Social Security Scotland and generously applied to ensure that we are safeguarding people's financial, but particularly their mental health when engaging with the system, while recognising that you do need to balance having a fair objective system with accounting for individual circumstances, and just trying to get that balance right. And it'll be key to involve people with lived experience to do that.
Okay, can I thank all four of our witnesses for a very informative and helpful evidence session today. Next week we'll continue to take evidence in the bill with a panel focusing on the concerns of carers of potentially vulnerable clients, as well as concerns of clients who have a carer. But that for the moment does conclude our public business. I want to move into private session. Thank you again.